Pop culture urbanism. They tried to cancel us. We're back. Hey everyone, you've pulled into another episode of Pop Culture Urbanism. So put it in park, recline that seat, and let's talk about Olivia Rodrigo's breakout pop hit, Driver's License. A song so powerful, it brought me back to when I was a high school heartbroken teenage girl. Jessica, if you're watching this, please message me. You blocked me on Instagram, but I found your LinkedIn, I sent you a message. Driver's License and Sour, the album it comes from, is famously about Rodrigo's breakup with Disney's High School Musical, the series, director cut, series of the year edition, co-cast member Joshua Bassett, and how he immediately started going out with Sabrina Carpenter, that heartless bitch. But this isn't a show about celebrity drama. That's my other YouTube channel. This is a show about the urbanism behind celebrity drama. And for Rodrigo, she's come upon a topic that's an urbanist goldmine, the role of automobiles in society.
I got my driver's license last week, just like we always talked about, cause you were so excited for me to finally drive up to your house. But today I drove through the suburbs crying cause you weren't around.
In Driver's License, Olivia Rodrigo is playing off the idea that an essential rite of passage for America is getting your driver's license. It brings a sense of adulthood, independence, and maturity. The song opens with how important the license is to their relationship. They were so excited for her to get it so that she can come over instead of presumably relying on someone else to drive her over. And as evidenced by the song's smash success, it's a message that jives with millions across the country. The driver's license not only symbolizes adulthood, but also the broken promises and dreams that come with it. There comes this whole bridge with traffic metaphors about driving together and how great it is. Think about it. Driving is seen as an extension of the self in our relationships. No one writes a song about riding a subway together having that kind of meaning. I mean, what was the last pop hit about the subway? Duke Ellington's Taking the A-Train? This is a major reason why car culture is so dominant in America. It feels empowering to own a machine that can take you, and you alone, from point A to point B. So it might surprise you that car culture is actually on the decline. In the post-war years, America found itself relatively peaceful and wealthy, considering it hadn't been nuked or firebombed into devastation. And so, young American teenagers found themselves with the means to join adulthood with their very own cars. These cars let them drive far away from their parents' attentive eyes. It gave them a sense of status, and it also could be modified to fit their personalities. Hot rods and souped-up cars became a major part of American culture, as the youth began to see themselves through the independence and individuality that cars gave them. But those days are slipping away. In 1983, the percentage of American 16-year-olds with a driver's license was 46%. In 2018, that number was roughly 25%. There are a myriad of reasons for this. Teenagers are looking to save up for college or computers instead of cars. Cars are technologically complex now, and you can't just modify them or fix them up yourself. Young people are more open to alternatives like Uber and Lyft, and getting a driver's license isn't nearly as easy as it used to be. Not to mention that local police are less tolerant of teenagers cruising around aimlessly or parking somewhere dark to make out. And of course, young people are more and more worried about climate change. Sitting alone and browsing your Instagram feed has replaced cruising around downtown on a Friday night. But all of this comes down to one simple fact. Cars don't symbolize personal freedom, independence, or status anymore. They've gone from being a personal statement to a necessary burden. The zenith of car culture is not exactly a natural cultural phenomenon. Throughout the Cold War years, the US piled a lot of resources into car-oriented infrastructure. Cities flattened entire neighborhoods to put in massive freeways, then added minimum parking requirements, inflated street widths, and rebuilt intersections, all to make our cities less pedestrian-friendly and more car-centric. In so many ways across the country, you can't function as an adult without a car. whether that's holding a job, visiting friends, grocery shopping, or visiting your boyfriend. For most of America, it wasn't like that in the 40s and 50s. You could walk down Main Street, and you could walk or ride a bike around town. Houses were literally built closer to each other, and they didn't have streets that ended in cul-de-sacs. Shops, houses, restaurants were all built closer together, if not on top of each other, something that is literally illegal to do in large swaths of the US today. And in that way today, cars are less a liberating luxury and more a necessary nuisance. Nowadays, driving is less a pleasant cruise and more sitting in bumper-to-bumper traffic. So it's not nearly as fun or cool to have a car today. I mean, look at how much fun these guys were having. For Olivia Rodrigo, her hometown of Los Angeles is a city that was built almost entirely at the height of car culture. And like the irony of getting a driver's license and having nowhere to go, LA represents the paradoxes of car culture. For all the freedom, opportunity, and liberation we were promised, we've mostly just ended up with traffic, smog, and a really expensive monthly bill. Ladies and gentlemen, we are cruising headlong over the cliff that is season 3 of Pop Culture Urbanism. We have a lot of good content coming your way. If you want to ride along with us on this trip, make sure to hit that subscribe button, hit the like button, leave us a comment, let us know what more episodes you want to see in upcoming videos. We'll see you on the next episode.